The late 19th century and early 20th century saw the rise of many painting masters in China, including Qi Bai Shi, Huan Bing Hang, Shu Bai Hang, Zhang Da Qian, Li Kan Ran, and Li Feng Miang. They occupy a prestigious position in both Chinese art history and the art history of the world. Among them, one is regarded as a legend in Chinese art history. Why, you might ask? He had already made a huge impact in Chinese art circles by the time he was 16 years old. That impact still resonates today and will likely continue to do so in the future. Some critics contend that even if he had stopped painting before turning 30, or if he had disappeared from Chinese art circles, his name would still be iconic in 20th century art history. His name is Liu Haisu.
With 3,000 years of history, Zhengzhou is often referred to as the cradle of the Yangtze civilization and the Wu culture. It is also where Liu Haisu's life started. Located in the center of the city, the Liu Haisu Art Museum was built to commemorate Liu's art and is also an important cultural as well as scenic destination. Now, Liu Haisu rests peacefully in his hometown. He's the pride of this city. Liu was born into a wealthy family on March 16, 1896. His father ran a money shop. Given his carefree childhood, he developed a personality that was outgoing and rambunctious. Doodle was the word his childhood painting teacher used to describe his work. And in his later years, he often wrote the word doodle on his paintings.
学画画，要蒙着一难听的画稿，大家在上面蒙，他就不想这样画，搞来搞去他就自己涂了。所以老师就讲，你怎么搞的？乱涂，你画的最差。
Yang Xiao Yi was Liu Haisu's cousin. Her father passed away when she was 9 years old. After losing their source of income, she and her mother sought refuge with the Liu family. Yang was clever and good at embroidery. She often used Liu's painting as inspiration for her patterns when she embroidered. Being the same age and like-minded, they spent most of their time together.
They two
青梅竹马，两小无猜，哎，姑姑家的孩子嘛。他说他从小心里呢，就是喜欢他的表妹。When he was 14 years old, Liu Haisu's mother suddenly died of illness. Liu fell seriously ill too. Later, his father sent him to Shanghai to learn Western painting. In October the following year, his father asked him to come home to to get married. Leo Haisu rushed to Chengzhou excitedly, only to find out on his wedding night that his bride was not Yong Xiaoyi.
父亲请人算了一下，磕了一下八字，说是八字相克，不行。然后就给刘海叔介绍了一个丹阳的钱庄的小姐。
It turned out that Leo's father had betrothed him to a girl 6 months before his mother's death, but Leo was kept in the dark. Leo couldn't accept the marriage and had a fierce quarrel with his father, but it made no difference.
唯一的办法，他只能逃了。逃在当时来讲，不是逃兵的意思，也就是一种抗争啊。他说我不行，我一定要离开这个家，我自己到上海去。
It wasn't until 70 years later that Leo Haisu and his cousin saw each other. Yong Xiaoyi was already a world-famous master of embroidery.
他原来的名字叫杨守玉，他为了海老守住这块玉，叫杨守玉。从此以后，未嫁人。
Shanghai was paradise for adventurers. As soon as he arrived in Shanghai, Leo Haisu planned to do something earth-shattering. He would set up a school.
他胆大包天呢，一个17岁的娃娃，非要成立上海美术专科学校。中国历史上过去有美术教育，那都是手把手传承的美术大学，过去没有过，这完全是个新鲜事物。
Penniless, Leo Haisu alone was unable to set up the school. After running away from his wedding to Shanghai, he didn't have a source of income. How would he set up the school? Leo had a well-thought-out plan.
他把这个意思呢，就告诉了他的大哥。居然这位大哥不认为他是异想天开，据说寄了几千大洋给他，我几千大洋还了得。 说明他的大哥身上也有常州经学派，包括新思想的影响。This
is Japu Road in Shanghai. The academy established by Leo Haisu was located here. After receiving the funding for the academy, Leo invited some of his classmates and several famous painting teachers to be instructors at his academy. He bound several brush pens together and wrote its name on a board, Shanghai Academy of Chinese Painting. And together, these like-minded young men put forward the school mission.
我们既要传承中国现有的艺术，但是也同时要向西方的艺术来学习。我们要在 残酷无情、干扰科技的社会里，尽艺术宣传的责任。我们虽然没有多少学问，但是我们有信心和决心来完成这一个任务。用艺术来教育国民，毫不含糊的讲，拿到今天依然是十分响亮的口号。
Surprisingly, their manifesto for student enrollment drew harsh criticism. The person who hurt Leo the most was his painting teacher, Zhou Xiong. Zhou argued that they were not even qualified as students. How could they be teachers? He felt that they were misleading people and that they were not qualified to set up an art school. Zhou Xiong was an influential figure in the art circles of Shanghai. His negative remarks in the newspaper were definitely a heavy blow for these young men who were determined to set up a new style art school. But Leo Haisu didn't waver. His academy was formally opened 2 months later, on November 23, 1912. Today, figure drawing is a basic course of our teaching. But a century ago, it took a lot of courage to introduce the nude model to class in China. At that time, traditional moral ideas were deeply rooted. Even normal social contact between male and female was considered to be an offense against decency. It was because of this that it was extremely difficult to find a person who was willing to be a nude model.
1915年3月美专第一次使用人体模特儿，找不到，找了一个15岁的小男孩叫和尚做模特儿，那不能老化一个小男孩是吧？登了广告，啊，应征的人也不少，但是一到了教材书教脱光衣服，他们也不懂什么叫模特儿，走掉了。最后找了一个要走，刘凯就问他。
Finally, Leo Haisu promised to give him a generous sum. And the man who did not have very much money was eventually persuaded. The figure drawing class finally started. In the summer of 1917, an annual exhibition of students' works was underway in the Chong family's garden, the largest private garden in Shanghai at the time. Among the work were some life drawings. Today, nude drawings are quite normal, but back then, they caused quite a stir in the society. Leo Haisu, director of the academy, became the target of public criticism.
相当于上海市教育局局长这样的人，他呢作为这样的一个身份的人，就去参观刘海粟上海美专的学生的学习成绩展览。成绩展览里边出现了人体写生，杨白冰就说，这简直是大伤风化，大逆不道。
Years later, Leo Haisu recalled that all visitors to the exhibition felt appalled. The director of a girls' school at the time went to the exhibition with his wife and his daughter. It said he could paint too, but he was appalled at the life drawings and scolded Leo Haisu. He said he was an artistic rebel and a pest of the education circles. Exhibiting nude paintings was destructive to the arts, and he had to be punished. Despite the abuse and condemnation, Leo Haisu stayed calm. He wrote that a great artist had to struggle in order to keep a creative life and reform the traditional art. He was indeed an artistic rebel. Leo accepted the title of artistic rebel at 21 years of age.
A 100 years ago, the Shanghai Academy of Fine Arts was a major force in Chinese art circles. Its predecessor was the Shanghai Academy of Chinese Painting, which was established by Liu in 1912. Liu remained its director for 40 years, starting at the age of 16. Liu and his academy became well known as the result of an incident involving a nude model, and it shocked Shanghai. Initially, there were only male nude models in his classes, which was already considered outrageous. But later, Liu went a step further and introduced a female nude model to the class. Many people were scandalized. What would happen next?
Scene TND, literally meaning New Heaven and Earth, is a new landmark of Shanghai. Amidst the fashionable modern buildings, the small alleys and old houses with stone-ringed doors remind people of the old Shanghai. Roaming here, people feel as if they've traveled back 100 years in time. Beginning in the 1920s, for three decades, the famous Shanghai Academy of Fine Arts was located here. Though it has been repaired several times, this century-old teaching building still looks how it used to. Many students have taken pictures in front of the stairs. Led by Leo Haisu, the pioneer and innovative Shanghai Academy of Fine Arts repeatedly challenged traditions and finally became an influential art school, securing its position in the early history of modern Chinese fine arts education.
He created Chinese art education history, numerous firsts. The first to open a school, the first to publish an art magazine, the first to use women models, the first to promote male-female students, outdoor writing. 历史功绩相当伟大，这是他的一种精神。海老就是在这个艺术领域，我觉得他就是一个旗手，他就是一个旗帜。As
the influence of his academy and Leo's prestige rose, a big disaster ensued. One day, in May 1926, Leo received an urgent telegram while he and his students were painting outside of Shanghai. He rushed back to the school and learned that Wei Daofeng, the new county magistrate of Shanghai, imposed a ban on nude models. After the nude model incident in 1917, Leo Haisu didn't stop figure drawing. He went further and introduced female nude models to the class in
1920.他说不妥，一种人格的表现，一种力量的表现。为什么到了中国就变成这样子？他说一定要把它要改过来。当时封建思想控制的旧社会里面，肯定是容纳不下的。
Leo Haisu had gotten used to living with pressure from public opinion, but this was the first time he experienced a ban issued by the government. He published an open letter in the newspaper in anger and asked the military governor, Sun Quan Feng, to restore justice.
Sun Quan Feng, he was Wei Daofeng's student. Wei Daofeng went to the old student and said, now there's a flower called Liu Haisu. Use this model. Sun Quan Feng asked, what model? 把衣服脱光了，露屁股给人画的，叫模特儿。那可了得！孙腾万家就正告刘凯说：“他说你其他没东西画了，你就要画这个，啊，这样是影响我们整个的民俗的。”Sun
Quan Feng's words stirred Leo to fight back. He published another open letter, saying that he would never give up nude models or give in to Sun Quan Feng. He didn't want his students to stop their studies.
他大义凛然，有理有节，使得孙传芳无言以答。The
young and aggressive Leo Haisu didn't spare Sun Quan Feng's feelings. At midnight on June 10th, 1926, an arrest warrant was sent to Shanghai. The following day, news about closing down Shanghai Academy of Fine Arts and arresting Leo Haisu swept through Shanghai. The Academy had no other choice but to stop nude model painting. Soon after, Leo Haisu was fined 50 silver dollars by the court for smearing the officials' reputations. Leo was forced to quit as the director of the Academy and abandon his dream. Many considered him a failure.
模特儿事件呢，其实它不是一个简单的在教育界的事件，同时在中国思想界的话呢，也是留下了一个非常光辉的亮点。它是近代思想史的一种推进，改变人们挣脱那种封建礼教的一种束缚的话呢，我觉得也是非常有意义的。实际上就是一种观念的争论，一种保守，一种封闭，跟一种开放，跟一种包容的一种争斗。
他这样跟孙传芳的论战，应该看作是我们主动的迎接西方文化当中的德先生和赛先生的民主和科学的精神。Instead
of backing down, the young Liu Haisu rose up to defend his artistic ideals and the dignity of art. Eventually, his stand won recognition from all society. The incident secured his position in Chinese art history. As a great painting master, what are the distinguishing features of his painting? And what were his artistic achievements? This oil painting, called The Girl in a Fox Fur, was completed by Liu when he was young. The beautiful girl in the painting later became his wife. They met when Liu was recruiting models in 1914. Zhang Yongxi came to see what was going on. For the two of them, it was love at first sight, and they were married not long after. They endured some difficult times at the Shanghai Academy of Fine Arts.
Paris is an artistic holy land that attracts men and women from all over the world. In February 1929, after more than 1 month at sea, Leo Haisu and his family arrived at this place they'd longed for. Leo cherished this learning opportunity very much. He shuttled between the Louvre and other museums to appreciate and learn from the paintings.
他的目光呢，是盯在了当时在欧洲的话呢，比较活跃的印象派。
野兽派，啊，包括现代主义这方面，自己接受这样的一种理念，进行这样的一种创作，同时把这些东西呢都带回来，研究西方艺术的韵奥，发展固有的民族文化、民族艺术。因此，在他的油画作品当中，中国的风味、韵味、民族的文化灵魂，处处有体现。
The annual Salon d'Automne is a top art exhibition held in Paris, France. Over the past 100 years, works of Paul Gauguin, Paul Cézanne, Henri Matisse, Claude Monet, Pablo Picasso, and other world-class artists were all displayed in this exhibition. In September 1929, Leo Haisu's painting, The Tiananmen Gate, was exhibited in the Salon d'Automne, making him the first Chinese person whose work was ever displayed at this prestigious event. The bright primrose yellow and the plain lines show the magnificence of the Tiananmen Gate in the winter sunshine. This work perfectly combines the characteristics of Van Gogh and Chinese style. It looks rustic, but the bright colors make the high building look more majestic and magnificent. The Tiananmen Gate was a hit. The European art circles began to pay attention to this young Chinese man. In 1931, Leo Haisu was invited to deliver a speech in Germany.
到弗兰克福学院去给他们讲了六法论
这也是中国人第一次向西方人介绍了中国的古典画人，但是带去还有很多古画了，也是德国人第一次看到中国古代的原作。
As he studied in Europe, he traveled to Belgium, Switzerland, Italy, visiting local scenic spots. He created nearly 100 paintings within 3 years. In June 1931, an exhibition of Leo's works was held in Paris. He created these works from the viewpoint of an Easterner, and they won sweeping acclaim in the art circles of Paris.His work, Luxembourg Snow, was immediately purchased by the French government. Famous critic Louis Laloy observed that Leo Haisu was indeed a master. He not only was a pioneer in the Renaissance of Chinese arts, but also represented a new force in the art circles of Europe.Leo's life in Paris was colorful. The different art styles from all over the world greatly broadened his horizon. But he was irritated by an exhibition of a Japanese painter's works.
很不服气，他们政府是有大量的资金来支撑那些艺术家，所以在办展览会的时候，他就是办得非常的豪华。那些欧洲人以为这个东方现代的艺术就是在。
Leo Haisu came up with the idea of holding a large-scale exhibition of Chinese paintings in Europe. In September 1931, he ended his studies in Europe, came back to Shanghai, and began to prepare for the exhibition. At the same time, his marriage with Chong Yin Shi came to an end.
张英是呢不喜欢应酬，哎，那么我父亲呢，他的应酬是特别多。第二次要去开展览会的时候，他觉得应酬是太多，他感觉自己应付不来吧。
Zheng Jiahua, a young woman who was studying at Shanghai Academy of Fine Arts, walked into Leo Haisu's life.Unlike introverted Zheng, Zheng was sociable, vivacious, and determined. Leo was totally attracted to her. In 1933, Leo married Zheng, who was 17 years younger than him, and started his second marriage. Several months later, Leo and Zheng embarked on a journey to Berlin.Taking 30 wooden boxes full of works by modern Chinese painters. In January 1934, the exhibition of modern Chinese painting debuted. Many influential figures, including the Minister of Education, Foreign Minister of Germany, and curator of the National Gallery in Berlin, attended the opening ceremony. The exhibition was a huge success. Within days,European newspapers published more than 500 news articles and commentaries. Then the exhibition was held in Hamburg, Dusseldorf, The Hague, Geneva, Amsterdam, Bern, and London. Leo also delivered speeches about Chinese painting art in these places. This tour exhibition changed the popular notion among European art theorists.That Chinese painting declined after the Yuan and Ming dynasties, and Japan was the only representative of Eastern art. Nanyang was a generic Chinese name for all of Southeast Asia in the Ming and Qing dynasties. It was a major destination for people who wanted to migrate living in the southeast coastal region of China. After the outbreak of the War of Resistance against Japanese aggression, specifically following the brutal occupation of Nanjing and Shanghai, 8 million patriotic overseas Chinese living in Southeast Asia organized waves of anti-Japanese and national salvation movements. In January 1940, Leo Haisu held an exhibition of works by famous modern Chinese painters in what is today Jakarta, the capital of Indonesia, to collect money for China's fight against Japanese aggression. The city had the largest population of overseas Chinese in Southeast Asia. This patriotic exhibition won strong support.
华侨都很希望有中国过去派的人过去讲讲国内的情况，讲讲国内的这些艺术，所以他们都会很热情地来买画捐款。The
exhibition in Jakarta was a huge success, and therefore he held exhibitions in other places around Southeast Asia. The large amount of donations collected from the year were directly sent to the front line in the war against Japan. Famous writer Yi Dafu, a good friend of Leo Haisu's, wrote a letter to Leo inviting him to hold an exhibition in Singapore.
In the end of 1940, he came to Singapore. So then Liu Kang and Chen Renhao also helped him to arrange his program. He held the exhibition here in Singapore, where there's a large overseas Chinese community.
In the preface for Leo's exhibition, Yi Dafu wrote that through this exhibition, artist Leo Haisu was able to raise millions of yuan for his country. As an artist, he'd done all he could for China. Soon the flames of war spread to beautiful Singapore, and Leo Haisu was wanted by the Japanese army.
When the Japanese came in February of 1942, but they went sort of underground, pretended to be, you know, a coffee stall, running so that they did not draw attention to themselves, because the Japanese were looking for educated Chinese, and it was a very tense situation.
Leo Haisu managed to get an airline ticket to Indonesia, but after he boarded, the airport was bombed by Japanese warplanes.
突然呢，他拉警报了，他在那从飞机上下来，到防空洞里去，日本人的飞机炸得很厉害，炸好了以后呢，一看，因为他们坐的那架飞机还在，那些英国人呢就上了这飞机呢飞走了。我父亲呢想想不行，是不是日本人的什么诡计是吧？所以他就坚决不走了。第二天的早上报纸登出来了，碰上了那些日本飞机。
Though he survived this disaster, he still had to figure out a way to leave Singapore. He disguised himself and blended in with the refugees in order to get to Indonesia, concealing his identity and eventually living in the countryside. But ultimately, he couldn't evade the manhunt by the Japanese special agents.
你这个报纸登了这么多年，你这个脸一看就是刘海粟的脸，你再改名也改不了啊！所以就找到他了，找到他了就要把他就是送回上海。
In Shanghai, Leo Haisu found himself caught between Japanese special agents and a puppet government led by Wang Jingwei. There are many different opinions about this part of history. Some say Leo Haisu became a traitor, but he neither cooperated with the Japanese nor took a post in the puppet government. After two hard years, he finally returned home, only to find his wife Cheng Jiahua had fallen in love with another man and left. Lonely and helpless, Leo wrote a letter to one of his female students who lived in Indonesia to express his pain. Unexpectedly, the young woman who was thousands of kilometers away from him suddenly showed up.
小英桥他那个时候南洋人士的，华侨的这个他个姑姑是五十大王啊，就是过去东坡的那个武士啊。又加上日伪的专门来找他麻烦，他心里很郁闷，很惆怅，也心里很不快活。小英桥大概是从一个女人的角度吧，同情吧，同情吧，大概是出于这么一个心理。
1944, Leo Haisu and Sha Yi Chao held a big wedding ceremony in Shanghai. Immersed in happiness, Sha could never have expected that the next 50 years would consist of hardship and suffering.
Liu Haisu夏雨乔艺术馆里边，我们有很多夏雨乔的作品是不完整的，比如说还没画完，比如说没有落款，没有盖章，还没画完要去照顾海老了。1944年到1994年嘛，整整半个世纪，相濡以沫50年。
In 1949, the People's Republic of China was founded. Liu Haisu didn't flee to Taiwan with supporters of the KMT, the Nationalist Party. Instead, he stayed in mainland China. Like everyone else who had lived through the old era, he would live a new life that he could never have imagined before. The Shanghai Academy of Fine Arts also entered a new age. In 1972, it merged with several other fine art colleges, and Liu became its director. At 53 years old, Liu was full of energy and enthusiasm. He entered another peak stage of artistic creation.
In 1957, at 61 years old, at the peak of his career, Leo Haisu collapsed.
他的半边全中风，不能动了，这个打击是最重的。For
a painter, having a stroke and not being able to use one whole side of your body meant the end of your artistic life. This blow plunged Leo Haisu into a hopeless situation. The burden of the whole family fell on the shoulders of Sha Yi Chao.
我母亲就帮助他推拿针灸啊，还有营养啊，一直陪伴在他身边。夏一桥把自己结婚所有的陪嫁全部去卖掉，天天拿了粮票去换鸡蛋，换小鱼啊、小虾啊，激活他的神经系统。After
receiving such good care from Sha Yi Chao over such a long time, Leo Haisu's body miraculously came to life again. This encouraged him to pick up his paintbrush once again.
恢复的时候呢，但是这手不行，那他就刻图章
上课，用这个方法来练自己这个手。后来他就刻了个图章，就叫真手不坏，啊，真的手啊不会坏的。
他后来的手写小字都会抖，但是他的笔力像钢筋一样的，精神力量强得不得了。
In 21 years from 1957 to 1978, Leo Haisu had 3 strokes, and every time he was able to recover due to the care that Sha Yi Chao gave him. The Yellow Mountain is the most beautiful mountain in China. It's known for its strangely shaped pine trees, bizarre rocks, cloud sea, and hot springs. It has a special meaning in Leo's artistic life. He loved the Yellow Mountain. He also loved painting it. The Yellow Mountain was a holy place in his heart.
He 对黄山情有独钟。他在黄山找到了他创作的灵感。我们从他刻的那个章上面就能看到，昨日黄山是我师，今日黄山是我友。那夏雨乔在边上说，黄山是你妻啊，是他的妻子。
In 1918, 23-year-old Leo Haisu climbed the Yellow Mountain for the first time.He was enchanted by the magnificent and unique scenery and unpredictable clouds there. He was tightly bound to the Yellow Mountain from that day forward. In the following 70 years, when he planned to go out to paint in the open air, his first choice was the Yellow Mountain. The peaks, ravines, trees, and grass had become part of his life.
他说黄山的松它是从岩石洞里钻出来的，很倔强的一种性格，它的石头非常惊险，但是它永不倒。它的云海那把川变化多得不得了，中国文化千变万化的内涵都在这个黄山里，所以他说他画黄山画不完的黄山。
Leo Haisu once said that the Yellow Mountain had changed from his teacher to his close friend. His feelings for it became deeper. From 1980 to 1982, Leo Haisu went to the Yellow Mountain 3 times. Even at the age of 80,He climbed to the perilous peaks and created many extraordinary and colorful paintings about them.
他的作品的话呢，气势撼人，而且笔墨精到，能够把自然的一种精神和画家的一种情感呢，达到一种高度的融合。笔笔有出处，每一个地方的话呢，都有传统的痕迹，同时也有自己的一种创造。
Leo Haisu's splash ink and splash color paintings of the Yellow Mountain not only embody the rich emotions in his heart, but also show the spectacular natural scenery. In July 1988, at 94, Leo climbed the Yellow Mountain once again, fulfilling his wish of climbing it 10 times.
一个艺术家喜欢哪一方山水，这也有冥冥之中的内在性格和因缘。刘海粟这个人，他本身他像谜一样，他那么传奇，我认为他真的就有点像黄山的那个烟云便便。他画这个泼墨泼彩的山水，真的是跟他内在的心性、跟他的胸怀、跟他的这个气度是分不开的，太像。
他已经创造了十上黄山的辉煌奇迹，他还要十一上黄山， 一直是耿耿于怀的要十一上黄山。
On March 16, 1994, people of the art circles followed the Chinese tradition and threw a party to celebrate the 100th birthday of 98-year-old Leo Haisu. On that day, he wrote an ode to himself, which goes, experiencing vicissitudes on five continents and surviving turbulence in 100 years. Several months later, Leo Haisu fell seriously ill and didn't fulfill his wish of climbing the Yellow Mountain for the 11th time. This four-story building is Leo Haisu's former residence. He rented it in the early 1930s, and he lived there until his death.
This house is always rented. I didn't buy the house. These two chairs are still there. These two chairs are still there. One is put here, the other is put here. My father's life顺利的时候比较少，波折比较多。越是有困难的地方，他又觉得越是要去解决。他说：“你们不能怕事，这个世界你怕事情，什么事情都办不成。”我父亲啊，他的耳朵以前很好，喜欢古典音乐，贝多芬的《皇帝》。
No one knows why Leo Haisu liked this passionate concerto, full of heroism, in his twilight years. We can only imagine how amazed and moved he was when he listened to it. At the beginning of the first movement, Beethoven wrote, "Fate knocking at the door." At 12:38 a.m. on August 7th, 1994, at the age of 94, Leo Haisu, the great master of art, passed away. The last sentence he said before his death was, "I'm tired. I want to have a rest."
Originally, his name was not Haisu. He chose this name for himself in 1912 when he established the Shanghai Academy of Chinese Painting. It comes from a Chinese idiom about a grain of millet in the ocean. He used the name to remind himself that man was tiny and insignificant, and he had to keep a clear mind. Those who are familiar with his life and work recognize his personal motto, which said, "At the end of the sea, the remote horizon becomes its bank. After climbing to the mountaintop, I'm the highest mountain." Some critics observe that this motto is an encapsulation of Liu's artistic personality. It ran through his life, which lasted almost 100 years. So which was the real Liu Haisu? the wild and unrestrained one, or the modest and introspective one?